بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل هو الله أحد، الله الصمد، لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد.
Either person within a family. This is something that it can happen to us. With Allah, it's a normal. It's a normal thing. Because Allah always warns us that كل نفس ذائقة الموت. Every single soul shall taste death. So if you know that, you shouldn't take it too much. Even though it's Allah who made people to be families. وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَكَبَائِرَ. Allah said He placed you, He made you into a nation so that you can know each other. From nation you come to family, because it starts from little to the highest. Because with family we come to like a nation. We are sitting here, we are one family. But when we live here, we are a small families. So that's how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants life to be. If the whole world have this kind of thinking, philosophy, there would be no bloodshed, there would be no problem in the world. Likewise, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us, He said, I created human being and jinn just purposely to worship me, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if this is the reason why Allah created us to worship Him, He gave us a way. He gave us a catalog, which is the Quran. The Quran, when Nana Aisha was asked, how is the lifestyle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? He said, "Kan hulkuhu al-Quran." His lifestyle is al-Quran. He is just the Quran itself walking. Meaning, everything that he does, he does it according to what Allah wants him to be. He does it according to Quran. Quran gives you to be patient, you have to be patient. Quran tells you not to tell lies, don't tell lies. Quran advises you to be kind to your neighbors, be kind to your neighbors. If you have those characters, those attributes in you, you are living as if you are living as a Quran. That's why the Sharia gave us five major things as basic for a Muslim to live by. In the hadith say, Bunya al-Islam ala khams. Islam is being built on five pillars. These five pillars, first of which is your sincere belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet. And then you have to read salah. You have to pray. And this prayer comes with it zakat, which is giving charity, sadaqah. And after this sadaqah, you have to fast in the month of Ramadan, which is the compulsory one. Plus those nawafil Ramadan that people do according to during the year, which is not compulsory. But if you want your position in Jannah to be higher, you need to do more work. So, and the more work you need to do, you have to do it according to the teachings of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then you have to perform Hajj if you are able to. You see, it's five pillars. Number one, you cannot do without the first one. It's a sign of hypocrisy. So among these five pillars that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pays for us to follow, the iman that you have, the dream in your heart, it should be very sincere to Allah and to His Messenger. The second, that is why when a person is lazy to do his salah, when we come to the second, which is the salah, there are some people, they don't offer their prayers regularly. So according to Ahlul Sunnah wa Jama'ah, such person, you can never paint that such person as non-believer. That person is a Muslim, but he hasn't got enough belief. So he will be counted among Muslims because he is lazy to fulfill his salawat. Some people will say, no, he's a kafir. Because the Prophet said, Al-Farqul ladhi baynana wa baynahu as-salah. The difference between we and those who are not Muslims are the prayers. But if somebody has a sincere belief in Allah, but lazy with prayers, you cannot call the person that is not a Muslim. See, so the person is really a Muslim. So, prayers are something that is connection between you and your Creator. If this prayer is weak, is less than what is required from you, there will be some consequences that you will face between you and your Creator. That is why it's very, very important for one to be aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because that's the only time you have connection between you and your Creator, which is As-Salah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when something happened to him, he's not feeling happy, he tells Bilal, Arrihna biha. Or Bilal, let us have contented with As-Salah. So Bilal will call for Salah. Or he will get up and do the wafir. That's why it's good to get up and do sunnah prayers if you can. But make sure your composing prayers do not leave them. Some people realize that when they wake up or they miss the prayer, they say, oh, the prayer time is gone. Yes, but it becomes like a debt on you. And debt, you pay debt at any time. When prayer time passes you by for a reason, then you have a reason, but any time you remember or you get time to do it, you must replace it, regardless what time it is. The only time you have to do it is on time, the scholar said, when there is someone who miss prayers about a month for some reason or sickness, that is why salat never fall on human being. Even if you are sick, you must get someone to stand by you to make you the way that you will fulfill your 5 daily prayers. Don't leave it. So maybe, unless maybe you are in a coma where you would understand someone behind you. For that matter, this is fall on you. But if you come back to your health, your senses, you need to pay them back. And that's why if you don't know the amount, or you know roughly it's been a month or two, so when Fajr comes, you do how much amount of Fajr you can do plus today's one. Zuhr comes, you do the same thing. You pray maybe a week Zuhr plus the day one. So you do that to be able to do your best to pay back all those prayers that are on you. So that's why the Prophet ﷺ said, the first thing that a Muslim will be asked, or any human being will be asked in the grave, is about your salah. If your salah are intact, your salah correct. The rest of the deeds, inshallah, Allah will waive them, whatever it is, will be accepted, according to the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But if the salah is not completed, they look at the sunnahs that you pray, because each salah has its own its own brother or sister with it. That Fajr, we have sunnah al Fajr, but before we pray Fajr. At Dhuhr, we have the sunnah that is you do before Dhuhr, and after Dhuhr, you have another sunnah. Sunnah al Rawatib. These are the sunnah of Rawatib of the Faraid prayers that we have. Plus some extra one that if you want to do them, which also can give you much position. So that is a bit about salah. And from salah comes to zakah. And even though we have five pillars in Islam, salah and zakah always go together. Anytime the Quran says, "Aqimu salah wa atu zakat," "Aqimu salah wa atu zakat," it always comes. That's why scholars say that there are three things that they never miss each other. Three things they always go along with each other. One of them is the salah and zakat. Whenever Allah mentions about salah, He mentions about zakat too. "Aqimu salah." Zakat is so important that it's like our insurance. Like in Western world here, you have life insurance, they call it, yeah? Life insurance. In Islam, that life insurance in the that they mean here is against Islam. But there is enough insurance. What is the cut that we give? Because this is the cut to purify you. That's why Allah said, "Anfiku mimma razaqnakum." You should feed with what we Allah have given you. So it's not you who got the reason, it's Allah who give it to you. And Allah give it to you so that you can also give to another person. So even if you give and it's finished, it's Allah who will give you back. If you don't have, so someone has to also give it to you. And this is the best insurance, according to this Islam. It's the best insurance you can have. Also, to purify you. You know, some people get into trouble with their wealth because they don't give Allah's rights in their wealth. Allah said, He gave you the money, so you also give it to the poor one. إذا أراد الله بعبده خيرا جعل كلاء حوائج المسلمين في يده. The scholar said, when Allah wished His servant with good, He put people's needs in your hand so that you can give it to them willingly so that Allah will be pleased with you. That's how you will get your paradise. You will be happy and they will be happy. But if you refuse to give, that will be something else. Allah is able to take salam. Allah is able to take everything away from you. You like it or not? Because it's Allah who gave it to you. Like the hadith we read last week, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah said this hadith could see that I give the poor people's money to the rich one, so that I'm trying them, I'm testing them to see if they will give it back to them
and how soon, how quick they will react towards giving the poor people their money, so that I can reward them quickly, I can reward them many times. So that's how Allah does His thing. So this is something that the whole Ummah have let the Islam down. And that is why a lot of people in the world today, especially the Muslim world today, are suffering. Because the reality of our belief and our Islam, because Allah said, "Inna Allah yuridu bikum al-yusuf." Allah said He wants you with ease. When I read the book of Allah, also, Allah does not want you with hardship. So if Allah said that, why would He make you a pauper and make Him a richer? So Allah knows what He does. Because He told us in the Quran, "Anfiqu mimma razaqnakum." You should give and feed what we Allah have and reach you with. So if you feed a poor person, he will be happy, he wouldn't go and ask somewhere. Now it becomes like a profession that people, maybe we may not see it here, in some other countries, begging around is a profession work. Even the people become rich, more rich than the richest, and they will still do it. So this is being a very weak Muslim. And because we don't put our trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah says, "وَمَا مِنْ دَابَةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ رِزْقُهَا." There is no living things on this earth unless its sustenance, its food, its feeding, it's on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not on you as a human being. It's not on anyone. Even the animals. He said, Dawa, anything that crawls on the face of earth, walking, crawling, everything, is in that eye. For man in Dawa to the Ardi, illa Allah is God. So anything that you have, the Prophet ﷺ said, anything that belongs to you is something that you've already eaten in your stomach and it's gone. That is you. That's yours. What you haven't eaten yet, don't count it as yours. And anything that you wear as a cloth and is torn on your body, that is yours. The one you pack in the box in your room, that is not yours. Perhaps it's going to be for those who will inherit you. But that's the way the world is. So this is like insurance that Allah is giving to us. So this as-salah and zakat, they always go along. Only few places Allah mentioned about salat without mentioning the zakat. Also mention zakat somewhere without mentioning as-salat. And the second thing is Allah said, وَعَنِشْكُرُ لِي وَالْوَالِدَيْنِ. In the Quran, Allah mentioned about giving thanks to Allah for creating you, making you a human being that you love yourself. He said, "Say thanks to me, Allah, and to your parents." It's always when Allah said you should thank Him, you mention Him, the second person close to Allah is your parents. So you must always thank your parents after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nobody else. You should love your parents after Allah, and thank them for bringing you. They are the reason of you coming into this world. And that is another subject, respecting and loving your parents and obeying them. That is why in the Quran somewhere Allah said that وَلَا تَقُلْ لَكُمَا أُفِّ. Do not even say a word of uff. This uff is just a two letter in Arabic letter. Alif and Fa, uff. The scholars say if there's a smaller thing that Allah could have mentioned to say, do not do it to your parents, Allah could have said that. Any child who made your parents wept, Allah will hold you accountable for it the day of judgment. It's very important that we should love our parents, we should respect them. Even some hadiths go on to say, if you have to cut your flesh, and cook it and give it to your parents to eat, you have not paid even a tiny bit of their rights on you as a child. The hadith mentions something like, you haven't even paid talakatan min talakatiha. When you are coming into this world, the pain that your mother feels, and the talaka means when a mother is in the state of giving birth, the that she feel the pain that she say that alone, one of it, you haven't even paid her right on one of that thing. So this is very, very important. He said, "Manishkurni wal walidayn." Keep on salah wa atu.